Recorded Books and RB Digital present Use Your Difference to Make a Difference: How to Connect and Communicate in a Cross-Cultural World by Tayo Rockson. Narrated by Corey Allen. Foreword. As a global educator, I have had the opportunity to teach children of diplomats, personal growth icons, teachers, secretaries, CEOs, actresses, film directors, and some of the most amazing minds I could ever imagine. People often ask me, what do these parents teach their children about success? I completely understand the intention behind the question. People want to know if there are any secrets or tips that they could also gift their children. But what's interesting is that oftentimes, when people reach a certain level of affluence, they realize that there are actually three types of success: success in health, success in wealth, and success in relationships. The third is measured by impact. Therefore, what is discussed in these spaces is that parents truly want their children to understand that being a millionaire also means impacting a million lives. What's beautiful about having an impact is that you can do it right now. And do you know how to determine whether or not you have given someone an impactful experience? You know when someone has experienced impact when they refer to how their thoughts or actions have changed, rather than simply praising the person they have learned from. People who experience impact say things like, "Oh my goodness, after I had a conversation with person A, I started to think about my relationship with my own family and decided to do things differently." People who may not have been impacted, but may have been inspired, say things like, "Wow, person A is amazing." If you truly want to leave your mark on the world, go for impact. My initial contact to Tayo was by way of his impact. All across social media, individuals identified how they'd felt seen and acknowledged when listening to Tayo's podcast, as told by nomads, witnessing one of his many TEDx talks, or consuming his posts online. They discussed what they were doing differently and ways his words shifted their perspectives. People connected with his work and publicly remarked upon its power. After having redesigned learning programs in more than 20 countries, I knew that this wasn't simply greatness that I wanted to have proximity to. I wanted to share it with my students. I wanted them to know Tayo and directly experience his unique form of impact, bringing light to the importance of diversity and inclusion. Tayo's message, "Use Your Difference to Make a Difference," introduced inclusion as a lifestyle that my students could wear as badges of honor as they stepped out into the world with pride and certainty. Tayo has always been very eager to share his perspectives with my students, and over the course of 2 years, I have connected Tayo with students from over 40 countries. As a facilitator and guide, it has been beautiful to witness the healing that has taken place. After engaging in one conversation with Tayo, my South Korean student Daniel, who'd stopped trying in school after a teacher referred to him as average, felt empowered to decide his own life philosophy and adopted the belief that his opinions mattered. He went from being the kid who rarely completed homework assignments to joining the debate team, winning national speaking competitions, and getting straight A's. Introducing young people to the importance of diversity and inclusion also teaches them the importance of their individuality and gives them permission to embrace their own uniqueness. This topic heals all those involved. There's a popular saying that was shared among my peers in education in South Korea: "I become more of who I want to be every time I read a book." As an educator, I want that for you. Inclusion is acknowledgement. It's connection. It's an "I see you." It's "you can sit with us." It's "I believe in you." True inclusion not only heals, but it empowers both those who witness and those who experience. As a global educator, I challenge you to not only read this book, but to slather on the learnings like lotion and wear them daily. Read each section of the book and ask yourself, "How will I live this today?" Live your learning. A good book will show you, but an impactful book will grow you. In this moment, no matter how old you are or where you are in your journey of lifelong learning, I am stepping in for your teacher and saying, I am so proud of you for taking such an important step toward your growth. I see you. You can sit with me. I believe in you. Hamia Drummond Bay, global educator, curriculum designer, and TED speaker. Introduction. The first time I vividly remember thinking about the impact of connection was May 29, 1999. As a Nigerian, I was seated on my family couch in Eric Moore Towers, Surulere, Lagos, deeply captivated by the television screen. I imagine millions of other Nigerians were as well. We were about to transition into civilian rule for the first time since I was born. That's right, I was born into a dictatorship, and the regimes I witnessed were oppressive, to say the least. One of my earliest memories was when I was 3 years old. I heard many cries and groans of disappointment from people outside my family's compound because our recently held democratic election results had been annulled. Moshood Abiola, the man who was democratically elected by most Nigerians at the time, was denied victory. The uproar it sparked was so great that it led to another coup. We watched as another dictator took his throne on Aso Rock, which, for those wondering, is our equivalent of the White House. Everything I witnessed up until May 29, 1999, was what many would classify as classic authoritarianism: muzzling of the press, suppression of opponents, and countless human rights violations. In addition, many of Nigeria's 250-plus ethnic groups were vying for ethnic domination because they had been ingeniously excluded from positions of national leadership. Let's call this the gift of colonialism. All this led me to wonder what it was like to be seen, heard, and understood for who I really was. So as I sat there in the living room watching as General Abdul Salami Abubakar handed over power to Olusegun Obasanjo, a former military ruler himself, I wondered what type of leader it would take to bring a bunch of people who held different values and saw the world differently together. I wondered how he would get people to connect. Little did I know that my adventure was about to start. About a year after that inauguration, my dad's job as a diplomat began to take us all over the world. My first stop was Ouagadougou, Burkina Faso. Here I found myself as a skinny Nigerian kid with a thick Nigerian accent in a French-speaking country in an American school going through puberty. Yep. Even in a place where everybody felt different, I felt different. I sometimes felt like a fish out of water in Nigeria, but multiply that feeling by 100, and you might understand what it felt like for me to search for my voice in my new environment. I mean, this was the first time I remember seeing white people outside of my television screen. I had previously lived in Sweden during the dictatorship years, but I was a baby, so I don't remember anything from that experience. So yes, for all intents and purposes, this was my first time seeing people with different skin tones outside of my television screen. I looked around for ways to connect. My default for doing that had always been sports. And back then, the only sport I played was soccer. However, I saw that most people played basketball. So I did what any 10 or 11-year-old would do when he/she wants to learn a new sport. I went to the library. Yep, I checked out all the books I could find on basketball. I found out that there were two doctors in basketball: Dr. Naismith, who invented basketball, and Dr. J, who played for the Sixers. I checked out the latest Sports Illustrated for Kids magazines to familiarize myself with the current basketball players. Once I felt like I knew everything there was to know about the sport, I decided I needed to know how to apply what I had learned. So I went to the best basketball player I knew, Michael Albright, and asked him nervously if he could help. I was like, Michael, I know everything about the game, but can you teach me how to actually play it? Thankfully, he said yes, and our one-on-ones became two-on-twos, then three-on-threes, then four-on-fours, and then five-on-fives. All of a sudden, it didn't matter where we all came from. I had a Taiwanese teammate, an American teammate, an Ivorian teammate, a Dutch teammate, and a Cameroonian teammate. And we had a common goal, which was to win. A common goal. That was my first clue. Establishing mutual purpose is key when you want to connect across cultures, which we'll talk about later. But, on that court, what we were learning to do was how to leverage our differences to work together. That one experience opened my eyes to the possibility of what a world could look like if we connected across differences. It also led me down this quest of exploring different environments to find the best ways to forge these connections and build bridges. I did all this not only because of my background as someone who was now going to be a minority everywhere he went, but also because I firmly believe that learning how to connect across cultures is how all of us can change the world. If we look around us today, we can see that thanks to the internet, migration patterns and new markets keep popping up, and we are experiencing a whole new world. The intersections of markets, customers, ideas, religions, and worldviews are shifting and influencing our priorities today, and will continue to influence them tomorrow. Essentially, leaders of today and tomorrow must know how to succeed with all these differences. The world is changing, and instead of resisting that reality, we must seek to understand it so we can leverage our differences the right way. There isn't a country that is solely comprised of natives anymore. Due to mass migration, millions of people move for various reasons. They move for better opportunities, education, jobs, and much more. Another thing you'll notice is that the internet has created a system where at any given time people are able to connect across the globe. Due to this globalization, individuals and businesses need to build their cultural competency levels in order to understand and leverage their differences. The world is much more complex than it has ever been, and with that comes inevitable interactions among all sorts of cultures. The fact of the matter is that globalization is here and not going away. Yet a lot of the world hasn't caught up. Global leadership is more important than it has ever been before. In short, we live in a diverse world. You cannot lead, motivate, and inspire the people around you if you're not able to create inclusive environments that allow each of them to feel comfortable enough to be themselves. The journey I have taken for the past 18 years has led me to the answer to a question that I have been curious about for most of my life, which is, how does one connect effectively across cultures? The type of people who know how to connect effectively do three things. 1, they educate. 2, they don't perpetuate. 3, instead, they communicate. These three things are the bedrocks of connection, and they make up what I call the connection IQ, or CIQ. My goal is to show people how to raise their level of awareness and consciousness so they can connect to themselves as well as cross-culturally, and how to do these things the right way so people can take advantage of the globalization and digitalization that are going on around us. But first, let's dive into why I wrote this book. Why I wrote this book. A quote from Haile Selassie. Throughout history, it has been the inaction of those who could have acted, the indifference of those who should have known better, the silence of the voice of justice when it mattered most, that has made it possible for evil to triumph. I wrote this book because we are in a time of deep divisions, and I believe that now, more than ever, we need to learn how to cultivate. Today's culture is defined by fear, uncertainty, intolerance, and reactiveness. It feels like a war zone sometimes, because in a world of nuance, we are governed by binary systems. In addition to this, we are losing faith in many of our foundational institutions: religion, education, government, family, the internet, the media. This isn't happening in just some places. It's happening all over the world. There simply isn't any clarity on what we find threatening because we all feel things differently. Despite this, I'm filled with hope, because we are also in the midst of an awakening of sorts. An awakening that allows us to see who we really are and where we can improve. The world has to awaken every now and then to the fact that we are responsible for the world we get. My objective with this book is to bring together people who hold different beliefs so they can get to know each other and create a path toward moral courage, empathy, compassion, and accountability. There are times when you have to stop being a bystander, and I hope that this book provides you with practical skill sets that you can use to transcend barriers and define values to advance humanity. We are bonded by our need to connect and advance, so let's connect and advance toward a more inclusive world. My mission statement is, use your difference to make a difference. It is the credo I live by, and is what this book is based on. It is about celebrating the fullness and breadth of ourselves. It is about opening our minds to people so that we can bridge divides and forge connections. I want to bring East and West together and have them sit side by side with North and South to trade stories of adventures and experiences they each have had. I strive to share experiences as a way to connect people of all cultures, to turn discrimination into appreciation, encourage diversity, tell stories to build global mindsets, and to educate the world about the beauty in all of us, and how we can work together to embrace our global identities. Voice, a poem by Tayo Rockson. For a lot of my life, I wondered what to do with my voice. It never seemed like I had a choice. I looked like this, so I must sound like that. I come from there, so I must be like this. Don't be too loud, they said. You'll scare them. Don't be too soft, they said. You'll embarrass us. All these rules and yet no space for expression of self. Nuance taken away in the name of systems and expectations. Identity stripped away to make people I barely know comfortable. I rehearsed several versions of myself so I could play in whatever movie was showing for the day. All this hard work only to play supporting characters or extras. I was never the star, because God forbid I'd be seen as too extra. So I did what they said. I became an actor in my own life instead of the director. That was before I heard the power in the sound of my voice. What a day it was, because I could finally use it to rejoice. My voice led me to the hidden layers I had covered up. I could finally see myself without any apologies. My voice led me to the mic so I could project even more. Yes, no more hiding. My voice taught me a lot. But more importantly, it brought me to this realization. Your approval will not make or break me. Your disapproval will no longer silence me. I'm not placed here to make you feel comfortable about your choices. My existence isn't something you can tokenize, and my story isn't something you will weaponize. I've decided to quit playing your game, and the only game I'll play now is to live up to my name. A warrior who brings joy, not someone that plays coy. What is connection? Noun, connection. 1. The act of connecting, the state of being connected. 2. Something that connects. 3. A person connected with another, especially by marriage, kinship, or common interest, has powerful connections. 4. A political, social, professional, or commercial relationship. 5. A set of persons associated together. Basic principles. Everyone wants to connect in some way, shape, or form. We want to connect to something, someone, or somewhere. Connecting creates a sense of belonging, and it is at the base of our humanity as social animals. We are primed to connect. Connection is also at the base of every issue we have today when we don't get it right. Don't believe me? Take a look at how our inability to connect has affected us throughout history. Colonialism, telling people that based on their language, tribe, or religion, they were unable to connect. Slavery, telling people that they were subhuman, so they couldn't possibly connect. Segregation, telling people that they couldn't connect because they looked different. Apartheid, a world where you, your spouse, and your kid cannot connect because of the color of your skin. Crusades, a series of religious wars fought because of an unwillingness to connect with foreign religions. Genocide, the urge to wipe out a part of an ethnic, racial, religious, or national group because of a refusal to connect. Nationalism, I mean populism, I mean isolationism, a refusal to connect with other nations, except on your own terms. Racism, a refusal to connect with someone who has a different skin color. I could go on, but the consistent theme that you can see here is the blaming of the other because of a disconnect, either real or perceived. Crimes of humanity have been committed and rationalized in the name of disconnection. We have been here before, and we are still here now. The only difference is that the disconnection that was once covert is now overt, and the disconnection that was once overt is now covert. Let that set in. It's happening all over the world through globalization, the internet, and in places without the internet. We have to push through, though, because as physician and researcher Dr. Dean Ornish once said, the need for connection and community is primal, as fundamental as the need for air, water, and food. It is as fundamental as the need for air, water, and food, so let's honor this need. I wrote the following poem while thinking about my life growing up and the world today. Walls versus Bridges, a poem by Tayo Rockson. I reached out to connect, but I was met with no interest. My bridge came crashing into your wall. I wondered what caused this stall. Will it ever fall? So I sat and observed as you continued to layer your walls with bricks of sameness, fear, hate, and false sense of security. This is how you found you're happy. To you, I've never been an option. I seem to be as dark and unknown as what's hidden in the depths of the ocean. Instead of getting to know me, you've weaponized your friends and family to be afraid of me. These stories you tell of me, they are exaggerated and limited. These walls you built to protect yourself from me, they are enclosed spaces with the same old faces. Here's what you've missed while living in your bubble. Your barriers have become outliers. Your limited scope has inspired hope. I will not just be tolerated. I will be appreciated. As your walls continue to crack and you continue to attack, my revolution will be televised and I will no longer be generalized. I reached out to connect, but I was met with no interest. My bridge came crashing into your wall and caused it to fall. I looked behind me and I saw I wasn't alone. Together we built a bridge and knocked down the walls. Here's to building bridges and not walls. Alozi. How to use this book. The book is broken down into three sections. Each section represents what I believe to be the three stages of connection. The educate section is the foundational piece of the framework and is needed if you want to master connection to yourself and your environment. The don't perpetuate section is focused on helping you know how to navigate the systemic barriers to connection. The instead communicate section is aimed at giving you the tools to connect with people who have different values from you. Sprinkled throughout the book are poems I have written that reflect the themes I am covering. At the end of each section, I'll walk you through the application of each stage by using what I call the LORA model. LORA is the acronym that stands for Listen, Observe, reflect, and act. These skill sets are the best ways to maximize your potential as you go through each section, and will include questions and exercises that will help you improve your listening, observation, reflecting, and acting skills. Enjoy, and take notes. Part 1. Educate. Chapter 1. Education. A quote from Nelson Mandela. Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. To me, true education involves a few things: IQ, EQ, and CQ, or intelligence quotient, emotional intelligence, and cultural intelligence, that allow us to get a better sense of who we truly are and how others see us, how we fit into the world around us, and the implications of our actions. Essentially, what we are after here is the education of ourselves and education of our environments. If we don't know who we are, we won't be able to know what to work on in order to become better connectors. So let's get into what makes up your internal culture. Education of self has to do with understanding your internal culture, and education of environment has to do with understanding your external culture. Both of these cultures involve listening and observing. Gaining mastery of your internal cultures is about listening and observing your biases, as well as your core values, and gaining mastery of your external cultures is about listening and observing to what is around you. Chapter 2. Education of Self, Internal Culture. What does your bias say about you? The first thing to understand about your internal culture is your bias. Bias is an inclination or prejudice for or against one person or group. Unconscious bias is the unconscious feelings we have toward other people and groups. Being biased doesn't automatically make us racist or sexist. Biases are human inclinations and ways for us to make decisions in life. Biases allow us to make shortcuts as we go about our days and act as a filter. They are the ways we categorize, view, perceive, remember, connect, and learn about culture. Although this emotion is not always negative, examining your own possible biases is an important step to understanding the roots of stereotypes and prejudices in our society today. These biases inform every decision we make: what we teach, who we hire, who we fire, who we promote, the marketing programs and policies we create and/or support. Understanding unconscious bias. As a diversity and inclusion consultant, I lead a lot of unconscious bias workshops. One of the things I do is to list out the most common types of biases that influence our everyday lives. I go through them because it is important for me to show my clients how their inherent biases translate ambiguous pieces of information into meaningful thoughts. I want people to see how our biases impact connection in the following ways: our worldviews, how we see people in the world, our attitudes and behaviors, how we react towards certain people or groups of people based on our worldviews, our attention, what we pay attention and listen to, consciously or unconsciously, our comfort level, how safe or unsafe we feel in certain situations. As you can imagine, all these will affect your drive and desire to connect, so it is important to paint the picture of what is going on in your mind before you make decisions. That being said, the following are the most common unconscious biases that influence our world today. Affinity bias. Affinity bias occurs when we see someone we feel we have an affinity with, e.g., we support the same teams, we attended the same college, we come from the same place, or they remind us of someone we know and like. For example, I'm obsessed with Harry Potter, LeBron James, and Manchester United, So if I come across anyone who shares an affinity for those things, the chances of me wanting to connect with that person are probably high. Attribution bias. Attribution refers to how we explain behavior or the cause and effect of something. It's attaching meaning to something. So attribution bias would be attributing someone's behavior to their intrinsic nature. For example, say you're driving and someone cuts you off. You notice that the person has a New Jersey license plate, so you immediately assume that the driver is careless because he's from Jersey. Now, anytime you see a driver from Jersey, your bias is activated. What is missing in this scenario is the failure to assess the situational factors that led to your getting cut off. Instead, a leap was made to attach a meaning to the intrinsic nature of someone. Beauty bias. This refers to how we judge people based on their physical appearance, especially when they are considered attractive. Unconsciously, many of us associate appearance with personality. So, for example, a tall person might translate as a good leader to you, or a beautiful person might be perceived as more trustworthy. Confirmation bias. This refers to the tendency to gather and process information by looking for or interpreting information that is consistent with your existing beliefs. An example of this would be if you were a hiring manager and you think people from certain ethnic groups make for bad employees. So you start looking for evidence that only supports this belief to justify your decision not to hire people from that group. Conformity bias. This refers to a tendency to behave like those around you rather than using your own personal judgment, even if it's against your personal interest. Maybe everyone around you has decided to go to a certain school, and you elect to go along with their decision, even though the school doesn't have what you want to study. Contrast effect, or contrast bias. This refers to the tendency to enhance or diminish something in a large grouping after a single comparison with one of its peers. It doesn't factor in the whole group. I see this often when human resource administrative groups are going through applications for students or prospective employees. For instance, you could be going through a bunch of resumes and applications with identical grade point averages. And when you notice an application or resume that has a higher or lower GPA, you decide to admit or deny the student based on the contrast. This is a bias because of the assumption that the GPA is indicative of skill set. Often, people who have this bias do not look at other aspects of the resume to see how the applicant could be a great fit for the school or company. Gender bias. Gender bias is a preference or prejudice toward one gender over the other. This is pretty self-explanatory. Halo effect. This refers to one characteristic of a person causing you to view that person positively. Maybe someone has done a TED Talk in the past, and you immediately overlook all other information about the person because, in your mind, this person is to be respected. This is similar to affinity and confirmation bias. Horns effect. This is the direct opposite of the halo effect, and it occurs when a characteristic about a person negatively impacts how you view him or her. Maybe you hear that someone you meet is a felon, and your mind immediately goes to, this person must be a bad person. Negativity bias. This refers to focusing on the negative aspects of what is happening around us. Research by several neuroscientists, including psychologist Dr. Rick Hansen, suggests that the amygdala part of our brain uses about 2/3 of its neurons to look for bad news. Positivity bias. This refers to people evaluating an individual positively, even when they have negative evaluations of the group to which that individual belongs. It is commonly seen within political science literature that examines positive respondent evaluations of individual political leaders, in spite of that respondent's negative views on government in general. Microaggressions. Microaggressions is a term that has been used in academic circles since the 1970s to describe small casual verbal and behavioral indignities against people of color, women, people with disabilities, immigrants, young or old people, and so forth. They are regular verbal, nonverbal, and environmental slights, snubs, or insults that can be intentional or unintentional. They come across as hostile and derogatory and are usually based on your group membership. Repeated over time, they can sometimes lead to stress and high blood pressure. Examples of microaggressions are as follows. I never see you as a black woman, man, person. Telling a person of color that he, she, they sound white or articulate. Asking someone you view as racially ambiguous and saying something like, so, like, what are you? And then proceeding to argue with them if you are not satisfied with the answer. Approaching someone from any racial group or sexual orientation and saying that they are pretty for said racial group or sexual orientation. Calling every Asian you know Chinese because you see Asians as a monolith. Calling everyone from Latin America Mexican because you see Latin Americans as a monolith. As you can see, biases can be either conscious or unconscious. They are formed as a result of programming and the socialization of the culture around us. Our brain automatically categorizes, evaluates, and compares things based on the information it receives. So this begs the question, how can we objectively monitor our programming? The answer? By reflecting on our experiences. To better understand your experiences, ask yourself the following questions. I call this the power of three. The power of three. Who are your three best friends? What are their ethnic backgrounds? What do they believe in? What do you bond over or argue about? What are their orientations, religion, genders, and so on? What other information can you think of? Where are the last three places you've lived in? What are the characteristics of those places? Suburban, rural, metropolitan? Describe the socioeconomic makeup of those places. Who are the last three people you've been in relationships with? What are their ethnic backgrounds? What do they believe in? What do you bond over or argue about? What are their orientations, religion, genders, and so on? What other information can you think of? Take your time and be as thorough as you can. I ask these questions to show you where your opinions and your preferences might have come from. My hope is that you're able to see how some of the decisions you make today are based on your experiences. I also wanted to give you insight into who makes up your sphere of influence. Your sphere of influence is anyone in your circle who has the power to influence you or you have the ability to influence. Your friends, family, significant others, teachers, or mentors. Identifying prejudices.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.